there's so much, Eric, with you and I. We could go on forever, but I was like, I always go back to when we were staying at that place on Canada Drive in Orlando, right? And twists and turns in the business and all that. But do you remember the day when that Rude came in and was demanding to almost have Sting spot?
I do. There was there was a lot going on. In fact, I think Rude had the title, I think, at that point.
Yeah, well, I don't know if he did or not. I mean, I just, you know, I feel terrible about what happened to him in his personal life and that, but he was, it was difficult back then. Because I remember, he walked you out to the car and opened the trunk. I just have a great memory. Remember, and he's, the gun was in the trunk and told you whatever he said to you. I mean, it was terrible.
Well, what was funny is, I had known Rick since high school.
You guys are all together.
You know, we all kind of grew up in the same, you know, zip code, so to speak, and hung out at the same bars, and, you know, we didn't hang out together at that time. But we knew we had a lot of mutual friends and acquaintances, and I'd see him on the weekends, and you know, I was pretty aware of Rick's, you know, capabilities as far as being a tough guy and all that.
Yeah, I was.
And then as you know, once we started working together, I always got along really, really well with Rick. You know, it was probably because of the Minnesota connection. In fact, he and I rode together right after I first got hired by WCW. He and I rode, you know, down to Macon TV together and Gainesville TV together, and we started becoming pretty close friends. And I don't even remember the details of what led up to, you know, that situation in Orlando, but I remember he had physical control over the belt, and I needed it back.
That's what it was, and he was like telling you and me. Remember, he was going to kill me in Philadelphia. Remember that night he came in the locker room?
Yeah, I actually, I brought Barry Windham in there, and I said, Barry, just, you know, whatever happens, happens. Don't jump in until it's absolutely necessary, but if it's going to be, you know, permanent injuries, you know, just be around.
Yeah, I know. He was going to kill me because he thought everybody was against him.
Yeah.
And it is what it was. I mean, he was, you know, he was impaired in the ring, and, you know, it's like, I loved Kerry Von Erich, but Kerry was impaired a lot, right? And Rick was getting to that point, and I'm not sure what happened, but he was like screaming at me, and then he was hollering at Eric, and you know, nothing ever happened. But it was just, you know, one of those things that was an awkward situation for everybody involved. And but what I was telling you, I mean, you missed the thing. We were in Orlando, and we did these booking things, and it was me and Kevin and Eric and whoever else, and it was like an easy gig. We had a lot of fun in Orlando, right?
But right.
Rude came up and got Eric and took him outside, and did he point the gun at you, or did he just have it in the car?
No, he knew. I told him, I said, Rick, I got to get the title back. You know, enough is enough. And he and I ended up walking out to his car, and I don't know why I wasn't afraid. Maybe I was too stupid.
Well, I was afraid for you.
I just maybe it was because deep down inside, I knew Rude wasn't really. He was hot at his situation. He was angry at a lot of things, but I had never really done anything to him. And look, Rick Rude could have torn my head off and not even dropped the beer that was in his other hand while he was doing it. Wow. So and I knew that. And but whatever reason, I walked out to his car. He opens up his trunk, and there's the belt sitting there right next to a 357. And he just kind of looked in the trunk, and he looked at me, and he reached in, and I thought, well, here it goes.
Yeah.
And he grabbed the belt, and he handed it to me. And I think that, you know, he made a statement, you know, and that was the end of it. Nothing happened after that, really. It was an awkward moment.
Yeah, the whole thing was awkward. Yeah, it's funny because I've told people these stories, and Eric can vouch for it. The problem, I mean, this is a whole. That's why this could be like a 3-hour podcast.
It really could.
Two.
Yeah.
The problem is that when Hulk came, right?
Right.
He wouldn't work with Vader, and he called Rick the Tasmanian Devil. He wouldn't work with Rick, and to this day, Hulk Hogan, after all the time in WWE and WCW, Hulk never wrestled a Rick Rude. Correct, Eric?
Yeah.
Never. He wouldn't do it. He called him a Tasmanian devil.
And he probably should have in WWF, because as soon as Warrior won, they programmed him with Root.
Yeah, but what happened was Root had kicked, beat up the Warrior in Savannah bad in the locker room, and that just kind of sent a message because Warrior had said something about Root. You know that story, right, Eric?
No, I don't know.
No, I had not heard that.
Okay, well, WWE, apparently the Warrior made some remark, probably just, you know, in passing. But that wasn't even a time when, social media was like it is now, right? But it was like one of those things, like Rude's not good enough to, you know, get a shot at the title or whatever, right? Yeah. So Rude, man, he got to Savannah that night. The building we've been at, Eric, and he walked in the dressing room across the kitchen and kicked and beat up the Warrior pretty good. True story. Wow. I wasn't even there then, but I mean, if everybody knew about it, if you were in the business.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, he just put himself in a position where Hulk wouldn't wrestle him at WWE. And when Hulk came with us, which was another trip when Eric and I went and got Hulk in Orlando.
Well, yeah, let's talk about that. So,
well, let me just finish. But he to this day, Hulk and Rude have never worked in the ring. Which is strange. I mean, he just refused to do it. He finally gave in to Vader, but he would not wrestle Rick.